the University of Trento, talking about a project on young scientists. So Begoña, if you would like to start, the yes. First yours.
Thank you, Cristina. Sofia, I'm going to share my the presentation. Okay. Can you see it now? No?
It's coming, Begoña. I think it's coming.
Okay, let me know when you can see.
I can see that you're sharing, but all the screen is black.
Okay.
Thank you.
I'm going to try again. Maybe it's the connection, but if not, if it doesn't work, then Sofia is going to share for me. Now?
Yes.
Now you can see it, okay.
Yes.
Okay, so I'm going to start introducing you a SMART-ER project, but first of all, let me to give you a quick overview about the ICU European University project, because this is like the base for SMART-ER, and this is like the mother project, not for SMART-ER. So just let me give you a quick overview. ICU European University project, it is an Erasmus Plus project funded in 2019 with the aim to work to define or sketch how the universities of the future universities will be. No? So as you can imagine, this is a quite challenging and ambitious project in which these 12 European universities that we have under the ICU network that you can see here in this slide, the 12 universities plus the Tecnológico of Monterrey in Mexico as associated partner, these universities are working, as I said, to define or sketch how the future universities will look like in 2030. They are working in these key elements that you can see in the also in this slide, open community, innovative co-creation model, cutting-edge technologies, and European education and research. So this is more or less the evolution of ICU. ICU network, as you can see, has a long track. It was built in 1997, but it was not until 2019 when they, as a coalition, as network, worked in this joint project together. And then in 2020, when we were in the lockdown, the Horizon 2020 program opened a call for, especially for these European universities, to reinforce the research area of these universities. So this is how a SMART-ER project was born, no? Under this Horizon 2020 project, and it was in a SWAF program where we applied for this SMART-ER project. So here you have the main, the SMART-ER project, that it is a research institute for smart European regions. And it is based like in three main objectives. It has three main objectives. The first one is this new model of doing research barrier-free, based in a virtual collaboration environment. Focus on deliver solutions to current and future SDG 11 challenges, and with a close connection between science and society, including citizen science, public engagement, and so on. The virtual research institute that we are trying to build in SMART-ER is going to be focused on these four objectives: maximize research collaboration within ICU members, share research infrastructure, create rewarding environment, and empower public engagement. So the SMART-ER approach that we are following is based in these three main actions. First of all, we are working to create a common research and innovation agenda, as I said, focused on SDG 11 challenges. The second one is the second action that we are going to work is to strengthen human capital and collaboration, and the third one to engage society in research. So to make this to make to implement these actions, we are going to use different. We are going to have in SMART-ER different activities and instruments as a seed project, and also the citizen science pilots. No, that it is the case that we are more interested today. So these pilots, the citizen science pilots, are going to be the test bed for the SMART-ER Virtual Research Institute. These how we are going to work with this with these citizen science pilots. So how we are going to organize. So here you can see the planning. We are going first of all to have during from September to January. So it means that we are going to have one more webinar in December and two more in January. Webinars to create community building. So what we are trying is to connect researchers working in citizen science project within ICU network in order they know each other, they know what in what they are working on, for them move to the second step in that is going to be in the more or less the first week of in February 2022, where we are going to have like a whole morning of co-creation sessions to design two pilots, two citizen science pilots, that then we are going to work in the design and implementation during 2022. Okay, so this is the objective first, to create this community of researchers in ICU working in citizen science projects, then to have these co-creation sessions to meet researchers that can work together in the citizen science pilots, and then to design and elaborate these pilots during the 2 years that we have left in the project. And the main objective to do this is to create a test bed of practices in citizen science for at the end to elaborate a guidelines or a tools that are going to be the base on how to work in citizen science practices, in citizen science for ICU universities. So as you can see, we are here in the planning, we are doing these webinars. So we are going to have these webinars until January, and then, as I said, in February, we are going to start with these co-creation pilots. The money that we are going to have for the pilots, you can see here, and we are going to fund at least two pilots, okay? And as I said, the result of the pilots will be to provide a test bed from which a document of recommendations will be created. Recommendations that will pave the way to the needed changes at ICU universities to allow for citizen science to grow and consolidate in the SMART-ER framework. So this is all from my side. If you have any questions.
Thank you for the introduction. It was actually very interesting. Also, when I'll be in Barcelona, I would be glad also to participate, if possible, in February.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. You accept volunteers.
Perfect. Yes, the idea, we are working in a virtual environment for these co-creation sessions. It was ideally, you know, to have this kind of workshops on site, but I think that the COVID is making us impossible for the moment to do it physically. So, but let's see what can we do in February.
Okay, sure. Thank you.
Welcome.
There is a hand up, Pedro.
Hello, good morning. Regarding the pilot, there is a minimum and maximum number of partners.
Yes, I think it's four partners of ICU that should be together applying for this pilot. So because one of the aims of these pilots is not to consolidate networks of researchers within ICU working together. So the consortium should be based in four universities, four members.
Okay. there is any help in the application form?
Not yet, okay. Because yes, we are now working to define these co-creation sessions and the guidelines for the draft of this pilot.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, if there are no more questions, then let's maybe move, and then I can share my screen in this case. Let me see if... Can you see the screen?
Yes. Cristina, maybe I can introduce you, or...
Oh, sorry, Begoña, yes. And I realized that I forgot to introduce you properly. Okay.
No problem. I will introduce Cristina. Cristina is a gene researcher at ICTA-UAB. She is a Marie Curie alumni, PhD in environmental sciences and technology. Her research is focused on the sustainability assessment of policy strategies and technology innovations from an industrial ecology complex system perspective, including participation and narrative analysis methods. Previous works have been assessed water footprint and water metabolism of agriculture production and natural gas extraction with a geographical perspective in case studies around the world. She is currently PI of the UAB team for Project Sentinel, SEEDS and LIVEN, dealing with co-assessment for the energy transition. A mom of two, so she's also a quite challenging project. She is also a member of two local associations for the transfer of scientific knowledge to city governance and primary school. Thank you, Cristina.
Thank you, Begoña. Thank you, everyone, for being here today. I have actually a very brief presentation because I'm more interested in maybe discussing collaboration options. But what I wanted to talk to you about is two or maybe a hint of three of the projects that we are doing in our group that I am coordinating, in which we try to bring together the concerns or environmental concerns that the general public and different stakeholders and policymakers and industries have into energy modeling, very specifically regarding the energy planning for the energy transition or the ecological transition.
I stopped hearing. I don't know if it's problem only.
Lean on my computer. You were not hearing?
No, now yes.
Let me come back. did you not hear anything at all?
The next slide, the sound stopped. The first slide, it was okay.
Yes, yeah.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Pedro. So I wanted to tell you a little bit about the context on why these type of studies are important for us, or why I am doing what I'm doing. Then also the main tool that we use, which is called EnVIOS, just to let you know what it is about, because it's the main tool that we use for modeling. And then the work that we are doing in the project SEEDS and LIVEN. LIVEN is actually starting on Wednesday. So what I'm going to present is what we mean to do within the project. And also SEEDS started in September for us. So, and with the attack in October, you can imagine that it's also going to be a hint of the planning and hopeful options for collaboration. So the context of this research line currently comes from this project called Sentinel, which is a Horizon 2020 project that is still 1 year to go. In this project, we try to develop, or we realize that the models that the energy system models or energy system optimization models account only for greenhouse gas emissions, but they are actually being used to guide the clean energy transition, right? And the clean energy transition maybe should be more should be about more than just emissions and maybe take into account other environmental impacts. So in this project, we are creating a platform that is formed by open software and open code and open access models. And we aim at including social and environmental aspects. And within the project, we did a study. We had a work package which was just about co-developing metrics, and we asked different stakeholders, the energy modelers, policymakers, and general public, what type of environmental information they would like to have about the energy transition. And they came up with a group of about in between 7 and 10 options. The first one being the use of raw materials in the energy transition. The second one being nature and biodiversity issues, water pollution, biodiversity loss, etc. The third one being having a full life cycle perspective of the impacts, and emissions surprisingly came only fourth in the list, right? For this, right before others like the human health concerns or noise or land use. So we created this module. This is probably very technical, but what I wanted to highlight here is that we are taking scenarios developed by different energy models, and we are assessing their environmental impacts, and then providing a database on the different impacts for each of these scenarios coming from different models, right? To do that, we are using a life cycle perspective because that's what people ask for. And we are also including a perspective called social metabolism that sees the society as a human, as a living being. Like, we have a metabolism, right? We need to eat, we need to sleep, we need to go to the bathroom. So in the same way, the society takes resources and also leaves pollution. So we created EnVios as a Python package that everyone can use. It's not finished yet. We are in the beta version. We are hoping to have the alpha version before summer. And we then realized that we were not including people enough when we were doing this type of modeling. So we only grabbed the information from people just to know the type of metrics that we needed to create, but we wanted to go a little bit farther and include people actually in the design of the metrics, right? So not only in the definition of the concerns that they have, but also how these indicators here should look like. And we decided to do this because when we ask people about why they thought these impacts were important, one of them was actually because you will facilitate citizen empowerment and stakeholder engagement if you can provide all that information. So for the next projects, we tried to design a workflow that would allow us to do that. And this is when we come to the SEED project and to the LIVEN project. So the SEED project is funded by an ERANET, by ERANET funds. Our funds in Barcelona come from the Spanish government, and we have four other partners: the Technical University in Delft, the Italian University, and the Technical University in Lisbon. I really like this nice workflow done by our colleague Francesco Lombardi. So what we are doing here is to assess the Portuguese energy system. And after we created a model of the system, then we have different scenarios for that option. And we assess the different impacts. And after we have all these impacts, we assess preferences, seeing how each of these scenarios or each of these impacts will relate. So we are actually including co-production in the definition of the system under assessment. We are co-producing the indicators that are going to be assessed for each of the scenarios, right? Because the high hydrogen penetration maybe doesn't need the same indicators for environmental impact as the highest decentralization scenario. We are also including citizens in, of course, the ranking and the overlap of the different proposals. And we are creating a web app. This is the human computer loop, very technical. We are creating a web app for doing all these processes. So we do have workshops. We had one a couple of weeks ago, and the next one is actually this coming Friday. But we are also trying to create tools so once the project is over, the lab or the work can continue. So this was important for us because when we define metrics, it's actually the definition of a metric also is going to give you pretty much the answer to a question, right? So who decides about the metrics is actually giving you a hint about what type of results would you get. So if you have an hydrologist designing metrics about the energy system, probably water impacts are going to have a big relevance in the final mix of the indicators. But if you ask the public, you ask the citizens, then you get a mix of indicators that is actually relevant for them and for their environmental concerns. And I know I'm preaching to the choir here because we all are aware of that, but it was just one of the important points of that project. Then the second project is this LIVEN project. This project is funded by the Spanish National Climate, the Spanish Ministry for Ecological Transition and jointly with the Ministry of Universities, I think it's called right now, and Research and Innovation. And in this project, which is also a three-year project like SEEDS, we are going to assess or we are going to take the Spanish Climate and Energy Plan, which is newly developed last year. And also is very focused on decarbonization. And we are going to do a similar process that we are doing in SEEDS for Portugal, except for in this time, we are going to try to connect that plan with the regional planning in Catalonia and urban planning in the Barcelona region. And that is so because we realized in the first preparations of the workshops for Portugal, that the scale of the stakeholders actually matter, and it's not the same to propose citizen science at the national level that if you propose citizen science for a local level, right? So the level of participation is going to be different, and also the concerns that people is going to have are probably going to be different. So starting in December, what we are going to be doing is four stages in the project. The first one is called envisioning, and we are indeed going to be creating new metrics for these three levels. In the second part is called innovation, then we are going to be adapting that Envios tool that we are using. We are going to be co-adapting, hopefully, and creating new methods of assessment for the metrics that we decided in the first part. And then we are going to be choosing the different strategies within these plans and the different scenarios that we want to assess. And the metrics that are relevant for those. And then we are going to do a pilot to actually create a community that hopefully will last in the long run and that will be decided with the full community. Here I have put this table just to give you a hint of the type of people that is going to be involved. So as you can see at the Spain level, it's not going to be citizens per se. The citizens are probably going to be involved more in the metropolitan region, but that is actually under development right now. So any thoughts about it, that will be very welcome. And that's it from my side. This is my contact in case you have any questions, and if you want to raise them now, that's of course they are very welcome. I'm sorry that I'm trying to get out because I cannot see anyone. And I'm just trying to. Now, okay. Yeah, so if you have any questions or any comments. I don't see any. So let's not make this longer than necessary. Probably was a lot to digest. And I wanted to introduce the next speaker, which is Francesca. So Francesca Fiore, who is very well accompanied by Professor Alberto Montresor, is a PhD student in social informatics in the Social Informatics Research Group in Trento. She has a background in sociology, and she studies the intersection between learning, creativity, crafting, and technology, attempting to design ways to diversify participation and practice in scientific dissemination and teaching. So Francesca, the floor is yours.
Thank you for the introduction. I'm here with Alberto as well, if you want to introduce yourself.
I'm one of the supervisors of Francesca.
Exactly. Actually, a lot more than that. Our way to work with the citizen and more generally with the population outside the academia is usually using a different channel that is passing through schools. So we try to do a lot of projects that involves scientific project and dissemination within the younger one. Today, let me share from here. This one. Okay, here we go. So can you see the screen? Okay, good. So we plan to do a different presentation, but also seeing the discussion today, we plan to change it a little bit. So as mentioned, we try to talk a lot with schools and local communities like cultural association and so on, because the goal is actually to involve people through the creative learning. So we don't have a specific focus. I mean, not specific as the one we heard before, but usually we try to include the different departments that we have in our university and try to bring different subjects to different public. So this is more or less, so of course our focus is more in computer science education, since we are in the Department of Computer Science, but we try to contaminate our topic as much as possible with other disciplines such as physics, chemistry, biotechnology. So we try to include other researchers. And as mentioned, what we do is going to schools. So we start from the primary schools until, of course, our students with different kind of projects. So with our students, we have the regular academic courses, but we also try to do hackathons sometimes. That could be coding hackathon or design hackathon. For example, the last one we did was for designing activities that we could conduct within the population in the city of Trento. So like a scientific festival for students or interactive installation for a scientific museum that we have in the city, or activity that could be run in our fab lab inside our university. Or we also have a kind of a mobile fab lab that is on APECAR, that is the old kind of Vespa, let's say. So we try to do activities also outside the city and in the valley. This said, the project we wanted to present today is one of the examples of what we do. And for us, creative learning passed through these four main pillars that are like, we try to stimulate creativity in the people that we meet, because we think it's one of the biggest part, being curious and being creative. So try to design new solution to the problem they face, like daily. So could be related to energy, could be related to waste, could be related to food. Every time we try to find a different solution. And we do this trying to stimulate the critical thinking and the collaboration and communication between students, but also outside. So sometimes we start from the idea that also inside the university, inside our institution, we do so many amazing projects, but we're not good enough to communicate them outside. So this is what we try to do, to communicate probably in a more pop way, but that can reach a larger public. And for example, today we present a project that is called Trentino Young Scientist Challenge. And it's a program based on an international format that is called Young Scientist. But actually the main goal of the problem of the project is to integrate the learning by doing methodology. So learning by doing, learning through making, as an educational method to what they have to do. And we have plenty of examples of how this model have been reshaped in different countries. And here we did 5 editions so far this year. We had to stop because of the COVID, of course, but now we're planning to start back. So it will be the 6th edition. But we do more than 800 students every year because we go in around 6 to 10 schools. So an average of 8 schools every year. So this means around 1,000 of students. We put 800 because the last round was with 6 schools. So we had a little less students, but we're growing every year. So the project is based of participatory learning experience. And as mentioned, we want to actually give the tools to the student to be creative thinkers and actually express their potential. So how it works? Actually, it works in 3 steps. Usually we send researchers like PhD, research fellow or professor from our university, from different departments. They usually run a workshop or a class with the students from the secondary school here. So the students are between 11 and 14 years old. Biology, sociology, so different topic. They do these classes with our researchers, and then they have to develop a project themselves. So in small groups within the class, they are divided, and with the professor in the school, they work on projects. So some example could be 1 year, a group of students decided to analyze and classify the different kind of waters that they could find around in the river, in the lake, and see the level of pollution. Or another year, we had students evaluating the social connection among people. So they ran an interview in a small town in a valley and in the city center of the region capital, let's say. So to evaluate the level of trust among people. So they ran this kind of interview. They were 12 years old, so quite nice. And of course, we also have volcanoes and experiments with the magnetic stuff and so on. So we have different kind of experiments. And at the end, they need to learn how to scientifically present their project. So they have to do a kind of a poster session like this one. In the introduction, we try to show them how to present a project, like the purpose they have, the question they have to design before they start, then their hypothesis, the variables they have, and then if they produce any kind of result, how to present it and understand if it was valid or not, and if they have any conclusion. And at the end, they develop their project. These are a picture from the last edition. And they have to present them to a jury that is usually made by researcher, professor, and people from academic institution. And at the end, it's not really a matter of who is going to win, but usually they're very proud to present it because they come to the university or to one of the main museums that we have here. And they really are put out there in order to explain what they figure out. So they can choose any kind of field. And then also they present it in the school to the younger one, because here they have some kind of school that integrate the secondary school and the primary one. So students from the secondary school explain what they got from our lab to the younger one. So this is just an example of a project that we try to introduce here in the schools, also in order to do a different kind of methodology in education. We also have two fab labs, and so now we're trying to integrate this a lot also with our university students that are usually more focused on what they have to do, credits and credits for the university. So we try to tell them that they can actually do different kind of things, also for pleasure, but following their passion. And once they learn something, we encourage them to go around for squares, festival, in the museum, and actually present to other people what they figure out. Yes.
So I would like only to add that, that the main focus here is on education. And so we are involving citizens, in this case, very young citizens, through educational activities with a side goal also to collect information about their perceptions about science,
technology
and so on. So that's the main focus. If there are any questions.
Of course, we are here.
Thank you, Francesca and Alberto. It's actually very exciting. Do anyone have any questions or comments?
Actually, before I was thinking how to relate the presentation you did before to ours, because sometimes we also like to, let's say, adopt other topics. So to run a workshop with our, because I mean, now we have a lot of schools. I mean, teacher also ask us if we have some activities to present to the classes, to the schools. So because usually students have fun, but in the meantime, they can learn something new. So sometimes we look for also other formats that maybe we don't have inside our network. So during your presentation, we were thinking if we can somehow integrate, since you also said you sometimes run activity with the schools and primary schools. So maybe there is space for future collaboration.
I was actually thinking the same, Francesca. I can see how. And one thing is, for example, if you look into gender issues, and it's a pity that Katharina is not here today, but if you look into gender issues one of the issues in energy management or in energy policy management and industries is the lack of women in managerial positions. And if you trace it back, it comes back to the thought about actually you can trace it back to secondary education. So that would be actually very interesting that maybe we can discuss, we can meet and discuss about it. But because now we are not that many people, and I think that's that has a good side, and is that we can actually all participate and involve everyone else that is doing something. So what I wanted to do, Sophia, with your permission, thank you for this wonderful slides that you have prepared. I wanted to create a whiteboard. And I wanted to ask everyone to just write down something about citizen science that they do, right? So we are about 8 people. So please, Oscar and Daniela and Ignacio, please just write down. Can you see the whiteboard?
It says that it's in progress.
Yeah, can you interact? Can you actually write? So feel free to add, I don't know, reactions, smiley faces, notes, text about what type of citizen science you do, or what are you working on, or something that you want to share. And let's take maybe 2 minutes to do that, and see if we all can participate and say something about ourselves.
I'm not sure we can write.
Because it says that for now only members of this organization can participate.
Oh no, that's a pity. Yeah. Let me see if I can change that. Sorry, I'm afraid I'm not able to change that. No, I don't even know how to do it.
It's maybe because
it's a missing feature.
Yeah, so. Also we don't use Team here, but Google.
We can use the chat.
Yes, you can use the chat. Yeah, exactly. Please go ahead. I'll be happy to. I mean, Sophia and I can translate your comments in the chat into notes here. Yeah. I see for surnames that we might have some people from Portugal actually here. So,
yes.
Okay, so we have here one. I myself am not really. This is not Daniela, this is Francesca. Education, then we have Daniela. It's taking a little bit longer, but we will make it. So Daniela is also presenting at the end of December. What else? We have Oscar. Let me just copy it here. Okay. So maybe Daniela, I know that you are going to present. So maybe Oscar, would you like to tell a little bit, like the elevator pitch of what you're doing.
Yes, sure. Hello, good morning to you all. So I'm speaking of Portugal, Aveiro, the city between Coimbra and Oporto, in the coast, of course. So to quickly get into the concept, this is not like it's a common concept in all the reference smart cities most of you know of course. Here near Aveiro, we have a city which we call Agda. It's a very small, cozy city. It's very emblematic here in Portugal because it's one of our case studies, like smart city case study. And what we are trying to really get is working on the concept, as I shared with you, the citizen-centered smart city dashboard. As you know, most of the dashboards that are around for some time, maybe one or two decades, are the mayor's dashboard, very well known as the mayor's dashboard, very directed to decision makers, politicians, specialists, and so on. So our idea is, I wouldn't call it the citizen science approach. What I've been seeing here in our webinars, it's most probably like something like citizen social science, where we try to involve our citizens in our research process. And the goal is to try and get up with an artifact. Of course, we use prototyping in our process to really validate some info communicational processes that could really go into a smart city dashboard, something a citizen has at hand, not only to understand the organic of the place, but also to be able to interact with the institutions that all that analytic translates. So if he would like to understand how the environment is, and if there's some pollution going around, it would be nice to also interact with the institution that is really managing the pollution and maybe help with some health recommendations or something like that. So it's not an unidirectional concept of dashboard. It's something that the analytics should engage the citizen with interacting with the institutions at the place. Okay, this is like a quick pitch.
It's always difficult to do the elevator pitch. I don't know. Yeah. I mean, thank you for sharing, Oscar.
Okay. Thank you for you sharing all your projects. It's been marvelous.
Thanks. Daniela, would you like to give a hint? Maybe if someone that won't be there on the 20th is here today.
Hello. Today it's not easy because I have my smallest kid at home. It's sick, so I have the TV on. It's not very easy to manage. But yeah, it's a very straightforward project of citizen science because the objective was very. I'm from sciences. I'm from biology, so it was a very science-directed project. It was a small project, a local one. And it involved the school, the secondary school, the older kids. And it was very nice because it was, I will explain it better on the presentation, but it was very demanding. I mean, it was very challenging because I asked people, the volunteers that were together, to collect water from their wells at home or at their neighbors or something. And every 15 days, they should pick up the water and make some analysis. A dedicated kit was provided, so they could make analysis such as conductivity, temperature, total suspended solids, things like that, and nitrates, because the agriculture has a strong impact here in the region. So what was given to the people besides the immediate knowledge about the water quality was also microbiological analysis. So they could have a whole picture of what was going on with their waters. And most of them found out that the water was not sufficiently good to use for domestic purposes as they used it. So it was also an environmental, strong environmental awareness tool, because at their home with their own water, they had a conscience that the water is not always so good to use as we think or as we thought. So it was very important because it was very easy to change behavior by their own interest. I mean, it was a very interesting approach, although demanding. It was very interesting because it was very effective. Who participated in it had the chance to see how spatially and during time, for example, with the rain, the water quality decreased very much. So it's very important to know that if it decreased it, if the water quality got worse, is because something on the surface got in the underground water. So it was a pollution from agriculture mainly, because nitrates and the bacteria that are not good for the health, they increased very much. So it's something is going on the surface that affects them, because and during the rain, it's obvious that that impact. So it's mostly this. And working with schools, it's very good because the participants, the pivots, let's say, from each well, were not all from the schools. But working with school, it's great because the teachers are marvelous. You that way you have sure you have. It's good to work with them because they provide the results. And every 15 days you had the results. Everything was very oriented because it's a mediation that you cannot assure easily, not working with the schools. So I really advise, it's everything in one, because we also engage the youngest for the science careers and everything like that. They also got the environmental awareness, and it's very good to work with the kids and with their will to do something. So I really advise in a project that everyone should work with schools. Okay, if you want to know something else, please tell me. Okay.
Thank you, Daniela. It sounds exciting, actually. I'm looking forward to your presentation on December. I see some other people who haven't shared. I don't know if you guys would like to share a little bit of what you do, because I kind of my mind is seeing so many potential collaborations in here. So, but I just wanted to give you the opportunity to share. And if not, maybe ask Francesca and Alberto also if they have any comments on other projects, or if they see any potential for collaboration besides, which I think it's already established that I am going to write to you both.
Yeah, exactly.
About this.
We really can have possibility of collaboration, because sometimes we work more as a box and we have the framework, we have the content, but we always like also to try something new with the schools. That is, as mentioned, a great field work, and we can also collect data sometimes. And the younger one are super curious. And you mentioned also before the gender issue. We also have that, of course, because in computer science, I guess our percentage of women is like 10 or 12%, so super bad. And so what we try to include also is the gender dimension in each project, but in mixing gender. So we tend not to do specific project just on the female side or something like this, because we don't like them a lot. But it's good to work with this in mind. So every time we also group students or something, we give some rules that allow us to have very mixed group. So, but for sure, I see many possible collaboration, and I would be super glad to visit you when I'm in Barcelona. So
yeah.
Please let's keep in touch.
In
a couple of weeks, I'll be there. So would be nice to meet. And also if you can show me something, what you do would be amazing for me. And yes,
so yeah, that'll be great.
Yeah, also if you have some format of workshop you would like to replicate, maybe we can also talk about the future pilots that could be run together.
Have you tried to do this with schools in other countries?
Not much, actually, because yes, we are lucky because here we have a strong network. I mean, teachers now know us, so they write us directly, sometimes even just a text on the phone, just saying, oh, yes, please come. We have a couple of classes. Would be nice to run some kind of activities. But our relation is good because here, if they know you, if they know that you are running fun, interesting, or engaging activity, they call you back. We didn't try the activity actually outside, except for some kind of hackathon that we run it in parallel with other countries, but that were exception.
Yes.
Okay. Well, but maybe something to consider. I'm just thinking in the pilots. I'm looking at Sophia.
Yeah, of course.
I think a very nice project would be mixing, like energy transition, it's education and computer science, which is part of the modeling that we do as well.
Yeah, also now we're developing a kit that is supposed to be useful in order to run little experiments, like physics experiments, that involve also computer science at home.
So that's nice.
Now we have this project, like low-cost kit that school can have and students can also bring home in order to run experiments themselves. So that also could be something that we can include.
That's very nice. Yeah, yeah.
Could I add something?
Please, Daniela.
Yes. It was very interesting because last week we had the national encounter, the National Congress of Citizen Science in Portugal from the network. So it was very nice to see some points working with schools. It was one of them because it's a strong one. But another problem and challenge is concerning the platforms. It was possible to see that sometimes two projects, there was one teacher, for example, talking about their experience, and she said, yes, but I already made my inputs on that platform, so I wouldn't do that again on another platform. I mean, this is very important. We must think about the platforms as a compatible way, I don't know, between projects I don't know how, this is more for the computer engineering people, but it's very important about the platform that we decide how the information is going to be assembled and compiled, because in order to be universal, or at least at an European level, compatibility between the inputs, I don't know, the information in each project should be exchangeable, I don't know. By putting the information in one platform, automatically it should be shared in other platforms or in a general one. So we should think about that. It's very important for the pilots that we are aiming to make or propose, because this is a challenge, really. And sometimes information could be wider, but it's not, because each project has its small platform, and so there is no way to exchange information. This is very problematic, I think. It's a challenge to surpass. I think nowadays it should be easier to do that mixing and that way to merge information. So it's a main point.
Yeah, I actually totally agree. We just started to run a benchmarking between the existing platform, because also we're trying to map the platform that actually offer educational format, let's say, some kind of instructable, but for schools. So we're trying to map this kind of platform and understand how it works and how they could be integrated. So actually, if you are available, we just started running a small questionnaire that is Google mode, so very simple, with a few questions for mapping the platforms. So if you might be available, would be great for us if we could share it. to also get your perception and
If you want, I can share it also with the other, with the network. Send it to the network, and they will spread the. I think this is the main way, because we have something in common. Every project from social sciences to the science by itself, the street science. We also have maps. We all aim to have maps and to have information from different geographical sites and times. So it's very important. The platform, it's the main, I think it's the main way to organize the information. And it would be very interesting to have a platform that would give us information on social sciences, projects that are going on. Maybe it's a suggestion for the pilots that we should make. I mean, in the same geography, because we are from Aveiro, so we have, you have your different points. And to make some local experiences, multidisciplinary experiences, for instance. So it would be very nice to have a network that would work on every spot we have at this point at the ECU, and to try to develop them with a main base, I don't know, it's which is the platform, I mean. Information could be shared and different information could be gathered. And for instance, the people interested in social sciences could be interested also in measuring their water quality of their wells, because this is a citizen approach. It's not, we are scientists, but we can also be citizens. So it's very interesting if we can somehow captivate the attention, not only for the environment, who is interested in the environment, but for other questions, for education, for instance, everyone have kids at home at this time. So it's very interesting if we can make this multidisciplinary and at the same time, maybe transdisciplinary also, because everyone has different interests or could have. I mean.
So, yes. I will share some stuff with you then. So
yes, okay. If you have my contact.
Nice. It's wonderful that some links are being created, right? That's what I guess. That's why I see Sophia with this big smile. Like, yes, this is what we are supposed to be doing. I see that we have two more participants, and I would like to invite them again if they would like to share what they are doing. We have very few minutes. I would like to respect the ending time, because we said it was until 11:45. And Vera, but if you like to say a few words of what you're doing, I don't know if maybe it's related or not.
Hello, everyone. So I'm also from Aveiro in Portugal. And I was working in Horizon 2020 project that had a component of citizens' engagement in these topics of air quality and also carbon, so climate change related. And we went also to schools here in the region, and that's my experience in citizens' engagement.
Okay. So also somehow related to education, no? And yeah. Also somehow related to energy and
exactly.
And climate change. Yeah. That's very interesting. Thank you. Thank you for sharing.
Thank you.
Are there any more questions or comments, or would like anyone would like to share anything else? I don't hear any, so I'm gonna pass the word to Sophia. I think she would like to say a few words before we finished. Yes? Okay. Yes.
Thank you, Cristina, for everything and for all of you to participate in the debate and just share what you're doing and how we can collaborate. So again, I would like to remind you again of what Begoña said in the beginning, that within the SMART-ER project, we are working on to promote citizen science within the consortium. So we are here now in the webinars. So we will have webinars until the 20th of December. And then we are also planning to have two more in January. So I welcome you to come again to the webinars and see more projects related to citizen science. And then after these webinars, we will have during the first week of February, most likely the 3rd of February, which is Thursday, we will organize a co-creation workshop with all the researchers from the consortium who are interested in presenting a proposal for the citizen science pilots. So if you are interested, please then save the date for this workshop to be able to co-create together with other researchers proposals for the pilot. So as you were saying, Cristina and Francesca already thinking about a proposal, so you could work together on this starting in this workshop, and then you will have 1 month more or less to prepare a proposal and then present it to us and see if you get funded later on. But this could be just interesting. So just to let you know, and then so the plan is that this co-creation workshop in February, then there is the design of the pilot during the first quarter, and then we will select them, and during the second quarter, or actually the third quarter, let's see, of next year, the pilot will start, and it will be of 18 months. So the proposal that you should think of should be of a duration of 18 months, and then let's see if you're successful in the call. So this is SMART-ER, and then I would like to also introduce a project that is going to be presented in January by the coordinator of the project, which is Incentive. So in at UAB and in other universities from Europe, we are also creating a citizen science hub in 4 universities to promote citizen science. So this is also something interesting, because we are thinking of the structures and the resources that that researchers that carry out citizen science need to be able to do that. So I also welcome you to come in January to the webinar to listen more about this project. Yeah. So that's what I wanted to say, Cristina.
Well, thank you. I think we are right on time. Super yeah. good when you are in a meeting, especially a virtual meeting that is actually ending on time. I just wanted to thank everyone, and very especially I wanted to thank Sophia for all the preparations, that she has been super helpful with everything. And thank you, Francesca and Alberto, for being here today. I see Francesca is leaving already.
Sorry, we were just in the office and another meeting was starting, so we just moved. But just be here.
Don't worry. I just wanted to say thank you for being here today. Thank you, everyone else, for being here today, and hopefully see you in the next webinar. I don't know when that is, Sophia. Maybe you
next
can
week.
Next
week. Monday next week.
So Monday next week, same time, right?
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. So thank you, everyone, and have a nice week.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Bye.
Thank you.
Bye. Okay. Bye-bye.